Welcome to the trading. And many people, they have got a very different background. Okay, some people don't know Selenium, some know Selenium, some people don't know Java over here, some people know Java. So let's start with the very basics, and let's start with how Selenium evolved over a period of time. What is it actually, right? Now if you talk about the brief history of Selenium, then when I first started working on Selenium, then there used to be three components in Selenium. One was known as RC. This was way back in 2007. I first worked on this tool in 2007. That time we used to have RC, ID, which is still there, and we had grid. Okay. Now RC is something. Let's start with ID. Fine. Let's start with ID. ID is something which will help you run your tests on Mozilla. Fine. It only works on Mozilla, and primarily it is a record and run tool. It looks simple to many people, and many people, they try to move towards ID because they want to escape from programming. That is the real truth. Fine. But ID has got a lot of limitations. Limitations like, for example, I give you say 1000 test cases to execute. If you run 1000 test cases on ID, it's you will yourself feel that it's not a tool which is meant to run so many test cases. Fine. Secondly, ID will not generate any reports for you. Right. So there are other things as well in ID. It's primarily a record and run tool. Okay. But it's a very strong tool, JavaScript based. Okay. Right. Now, to overcome all these disadvantages, people started using RC. Now, RC could test on multiple browsers. Mozilla, I, Chrome, Opera, Safari, fine, and it could actually work with multiple languages as well. You could use Java with RC, you could use C#, Python, Perl, PHP, fine, but there are many other languages as well, right? But it's not that if your website is made in Java, you need to use Selenium RC with Java. No. If your website is made in any language, whether it is C#, PHP and all anything, you can use RC with any language to test it. It is independent of the language in which the website is made. Fine. Now, what happened was RC had various drawbacks in it. First of all, there was a major drawback. There used to be RC server, which had to be started, stopped, and it was not a very neat process. Fine. And there were other things as well which actually forced Google. Google came into the picture, and it's the brainchild of Google that today we have something known as WebDriver in the market. WebDriver came up in 2011. Officially it started in 2009, but it launched in 2011, and it removed major drawbacks in RC. It also worked with multiple browsers and multiple languages, but primarily 70% of the industry uses Java. Okay, why do people use Java? People also use Ruby, people also use Python, but Java is famous. The first reason being it's platform independent. You can run Java code on Windows, Linux or any other operating system. Fine. IDE, it remained same. IDE is still the same. Fine. The versions have changed. That's it. And earlier it used to be grid. Now this is grid 2. Grid 2 supports WebDriver and RC both. Okay. RC now has been deprecated. This is no longer been enhanced, no bug fixes, nothing like that. Still people use it. There are companies who have their systems still implemented in RC, and they say that when it is stable, why should we move to WebDriver? Because WebDriver and RC, they are completely different. Okay, if you think that in order to learn WebDriver you should be an RC guy and then you can learn WebDriver, it is not the case. You can directly go and learn WebDriver instead of learning RC. These two are completely different tools. Okay, so all this history and all these various components of Selenium makes Selenium a little vast. Fine. So that's why it is easy. It is not difficult, but the number of topics which we have to cover, they become very vast, right? Now, Selenium as a tool, what does a tool does? It is for web application testing only. Okay, Selenium as a tool cannot test your Windows based components or anything. It is only for web application testing. It automates your browser based applications. Fine. These days, the capabilities to test iPhone based websites and the websites which open in Android, they are also inducted in WebDriver. Okay, right. So we will be gradually moving in this course. First of all, we'll be concentrating a little bit on Java, and after that we will be looking at Selenium WebDriver and then frameworks and then Grid, right? So any questions from anybody before I move further? Any question? What is Grid 2 and what is the difference in WebDriver and Grid 2? Okay, I didn't tell you about Grid. Grid is something which helps you to run your test cases parallelly. In Grid, you set up a hub. Hub is like a central PC and you connect multiple PCs to it. And suppose you have got say 3000 test cases. Then you can distribute these test cases among multiple machines and you can execute them parallelly. Right? So this is what Grid does. It saves your time. Right? Or for example, like we people also do it like that. There are 3000 test cases. All the test cases, they have to be executed on Chrome, Mozilla and IE. So you make a Grid system with three PCs attached. On one PC you test on Firefox, on other PC you test on Chrome, on third PC you test on IE. Fine. Or the other way around can be that there are three PCs and on one PC you test them on Firefox 10, on other PC you test them on Firefox 9, and on other PC you test them on say Firefox 18. So you can also do like that. So it depends. If you want to test the browser compatibility of the application and all everything, you can distribute the test cases the way you want. Right. Any other question?
I exactly trying to understand what's the difference between RC and WebDriver. One thing, no bug fixes in RC.
No, but not the bug fixes in RC. Okay.
Yeah, other than that.
It's not like that people fixed bugs in RC and they made WebDriver. It is not like that. Fine. RC had various limitations, various drawbacks. The API was not so big. Fine. And to overcome all those drawbacks which RC had, fine, we make WebDriver. For example, taking a very simple example which any automation tool can do. If you talk about QTP, right? Suppose this is your screen on which this is your monitor and the web application is coming up inside it, right? Using any automation tool, you can extract a certain portion of the page, and suppose in that page you have got five links and you need to print the names of five links. It's very easy to do it with QTP, but with RC, this was next to impossible. So stuff like that. There were technical difficulties with RC. Many times people used to extend RC, write their own extensions and all. So that used to be not so simple task. So that's why WebDriver API, it came into the picture. Right? And it removed major drawbacks. It is not like RC. This was existing RC and people added something into it and the whole thing was called WebDriver. It is not like that. Both of them are completely different. Okay, both of them are the difference is as big as the difference between, you can say, Selenium and QTP. Okay, people who have worked on RC for 5-6 years, when they look at WebDriver, they are not able to understand it. Fine. Now another question being asked is, what is the difference between WebDriver and Grid? Well, Grid is something which helps you to run your test cases parallelly. But to make your test cases, you need to have WebDriver. In WebDriver, I will make say 3 test cases. I will automate 4-5 test cases. But if I have to execute all of them parallelly, I will use grid. Okay, WebDriver is used for the generation of your test cases and grid is used to run them parallelly. Right? Any other question from anybody?
Ashish, I am not clear yet. You said Selenium is only for web app testing.
Yes.
So how are you going to test those without non-web, I mean non-web app?
It's not for that. It's only for web application testing. If you go to the website, selenium.hq.org, the official website of Selenium, right? The first line written on this is Selenium automates browsers. It's not for desktop based application.
How are you going to test desktop based application?
How will I test it when the tool is not meant for this? I cannot test any desktop based application.
Thank you.
Hey, actually we re-
just a minute.
We recorded couple of not couple of more than 200 cases in IDE already.
Yeah.
So we are trying to move to RC or WebDriver. Can the already existing recorded scripts can be used?
I'll answer that question. Just give me 2 minutes. I'll answer that question. Right. How to, first of all, the question, how do I integrate grid and WebDriver and exit? I will talk about that, but first of all, I'll have to talk about WebDriver in this course. I will take up grid in the end of the course, right? Because in order to teach grid, I need to have WebDriver. Fine. Now there is another interesting feature which is liked by many people. Okay. The feature is that in your IDE, you make a test case. IDE is primarily a record and run tool, and then you convert the test case into WebDriver and use it. This looks very simple, okay, but don't do this. It is not successful every time. For a beginner, it looks like, oh wow, I can simply record something, convert the test case and simply run it in WebDriver. For those of you who are getting confused, don't worry, right? The questions and doubts being asked in this session right now are from people who have already worked little bit on Selenium, right? But as I start teaching you in some time, I will start from the basics. Okay, there are people in this course I know who will not be knowing anything about WebDriver, right? For a layman, I'll just tell you, if you have to go to gmail.com, enter your username and password with Selenium. This will be done using WebDriver. Okay. And if you have two test cases, that is, one is on Gmail, you have to enter username and password, and other is that you have to go to Gmail and enter and register yourself a new account. You have to register for a new account. So these are the two test cases. Both of them are implemented in WebDriver. If you have to run them parallelly, then you run them using grid. Okay, grid comes to run the test cases parallelly. So first I will be teaching you in the course how to use WebDriver, and in the end I will tell you how to configure grid with it. Fine. Now, yeah, so as I was telling you, don't ever convert your test cases from IDE to WebDriver or grid. It looks simple, but it will make your life hell, right? Telling you from my experience. Okay, fine. So any other question from anybody before I move further? No question. All right, now let's start with the course, the actual course. The first mistake, the very basic mistake which people make. What is the very basic mistake with which people make when they start with Selenium? That is, they directly jump over to Selenium. Okay, don't directly jump over to Selenium. You will not be so successful, right? First go and learn Java. Even if you put 1 week in Java, 2 weeks in Java, that will save a lot of your time in future. Because I have been hearing people that there is no documentation for Selenium, there is nothing for Selenium on the internet. Everything is present. If you go to the download section of Selenium, and you will see a link called Java doc, Java documentation. Fine. If you click on this, you will see this documentation coming up. These are Java docs Okay, if you don't know the concept of object-oriented programming, if you don't know the concepts of object-oriented programming, then you cannot learn Selenium. Now, this whole documentation is object-oriented. Okay, all the object information and the class information and all, everything is in it. All you need to do is you need to be smart enough and experienced a little bit to understand it, right? So first of all, let us start with Java. Importance is Java. I will tell you the concept of Java and then I'll tell you how to use it in Selenium parallelly. For this course, I'm at least assuming that you guys are aware of little bit of programming. That is what a while loop is, what a for loop is, what an if statement is. Fine. I'm assuming that you have got that much of background. Fine. Assuming this much of background, I will be continuing further, right? So the first thing which you need to do is that I hope everybody has it already. You need to install Java on your machine. Just go to Google and type download Java and install Java from here. Note, if you have a 64-bit machine, if your machine is 64-bit, most of the machines coming up these days, especially with Windows 8 and all, are 64-bit. Then please install JDK as well, Java Development Kit. Go to this link and on this link, install JDK. Right? Now, once you have done that, you have to get the editor for Java language. Editor for Java language is Eclipse. Just go to google.com and type download Eclipse Indigo. There are various packages for Eclipse, Juno packages and all everything. I specifically asked people to install, so to download and configure Indigo. There is a reason behind it. As I go further in the course, you will come to know the reason. Fine. Just get Eclipse Indigo. You can get it from here. And go to Indigo packages out here. And just install Java IDE for Eclipse EE developers based on your operating system. Before downloading, make sure you have installed Java, and if you have a 64-bit machine, you have installed JDK as well. Fine. Now, Eclipse comes as a bundle. If you look at this is my Eclipse. Fine. When you open Eclipse after downloading it, you will get all these files. It's not installable, it comes as a bundle. You just have to open up Eclipse by double clicking on the exe file and hold on, let it launch. This is the workspace launcher. Fine, this tells you the place where you will be storing all your code, whatever code and whatever projects you will be making, you will be storing on this location. Fine. I'll give a new location over here. Say Feb weekend. So my workspace, the code which I will be making in my in this current batch, I'll be storing it at this location. Right. Click on OK. And let Eclipse start up. Hold on, it will take some time, right? Because I just created a new workspace, right? Eclipse is like an editor for Java language. Like for C, you had Turbo C, fine. For Eclipse, you had this thing, and if you close it, this is the welcome screen. Fine, you can close the welcome screen from here and you will have a page like this coming up. Right, now this is the project explorer on the left side on which we will be storing all the projects. In the center, we'll be keeping all the coding and all everything, and at the bottom you will see the output. Fine, right. Now, how do I go about it? Right, how do I start with Java? The first thing which you need to do is that you need to make a new Java project. To make a new Java project, you need to go to File, New, hold on, new project, okay, or you can just right click here, go to new project, select Java project. If you don't get this option, expand Java and select Java project. Fine, I'll name my Java project day one. Fine. So if you look at the whole thing now, you have created a Java project with the name day one. Inside this project, you'll have a source folder and JRE system library. This JRE system library is actually Java, which was installed on your system. Okay. This JRE system library is actually Java, which is installed on your system. And inside the source folder, I'll be keeping all my code and all the project related stuff. Right. If you look at day one, right click on day one, you'll get lot of options here. We will be using these options very, very frequently as we proceed with the course, especially the option called properties of a project. Fine. If you go to the properties option, you will see various tabs on the left hand side, and one of them is resource. Under the resource tab, you will see the location of this project. See, this location is under the workspace which I had created. You can copy this and you can go to this location. You'll find the project. Okay. Inside the project, you'll find various things. There will be a source folder, and out of all the things, the source folder is visible in Eclipse. Rest, all the things are not coming in Eclipse. They will come up, they will not come up, okay, but we will be using them gradually. Fine. So you'll come to know about everything, right? Now in the source folder, I'm going to make my first Java program. How do you make a Java class file? You right click on the source folder, go to new and select class. On the source folder, select new class. Okay, name that class some class. Say my first program. Check on this checkbox, public static void main, and you will see that some code is generated automatically. Fine. Hold on, I'll just increase the font size. Right. So the first line is public class my first program. This is the name of the class. Remember, in Java, the name of the class and name of the file both should be same. These two names should be same. If I give a different name out here, then I will get an error. Eclipse will immediately throw me an error, and if you move your mouse over the error, Eclipse will give you two fixes. Either name this thing or name the file. Okay, so I'll name this. Now, this is the main function, public static void main, right? In this main function, we will be writing all the code. For example, if I write system.out.println, system.out.println is the command to print something in Java. I write over here, hello Selenium. And I run the code. How do you run the code? You click on this icon on the top and you run it. It will print hello Selenium. Right? There's a shortcut to type system.out.println. You just type SYSO and hit control plus spacebar. Right? So you type SYSO and hit control spacebar of your keyboard. This command will come up. Fine, this is the first Java program in which you have just gone and you have printed something. Giving you a brief refresher, There are various data types in Java, like you have got integers and you have got long equals to this. There's a difference between long and integer. Integer is less, it's small in size. If you have a big number which you want to store, you can store it in long, right? For example, I store this number in integer. I'll get an error, right? Because the size of integer is fixed, right? But if I store the same number in long, right, you have to put L in the end, this will not throw an error. Okay, so the capacity of long is bigger than an integer. Similarly, you have got, if you have a decimal number and if you want to store, you have got double D and you can store it in a decimal. Fine. Integers and longs, they cannot store decimals. These are for non-decimal numbers. Fine. Similarly, you have something known as Boolean. Say Boolean C E equals to true. Boolean can have two values stored in it, true or false. Fine. So this is a brief overview of the various data types. You also have a string in Java, for example, string x equals to hello there, how are you. So string can be used to store various characters together. Fine. So this is just a brief overview of various data types and string and all. This is present in all the programming languages, right? This is present in all the programming languages. But now, how do we use this stuff in Selenium? That's the major goal. Okay, if you go to the physical location where the project is lying, the project is lying under day one, right? In the source folder, you will see my first program.java file. Okay. In this Java file, you will get the same code which I had written in that particular file. Right. If you look at the bin folder, okay. If you look at the bin folder holds the class file corresponding to Java file. If you open this class file, you will not be able to understand anything. Okay, now what happens is that in Java, if you have a Java file that gets converted into a class file, dot class file. Suppose I have abc.java. When I compile and run it, if it compiles successfully, it will be converted into a class file known as abc.class. Similarly, over here, my first program.class. What is a class file? Class file is like an exe file. It is executable. Right? You can deploy this class file onto multiple operating systems and this will run. Okay? Now, suppose you have got lot of class files together. These are all the class files in your project and it's huge, and you have to give all the class files somewhere. Suppose you have to give it to a client, or you have a server on which you have to upload the class files. Fine. So how do you use all these class files? The simplest answer would be put all the class files in a single file known as a zip file and send them anywhere where you want. But in Java, we name this zip file as a jar file. Okay, a jar file is nothing but it is a collection of many class files. For example, hold on, this is JRE system library. Okay, this JRE system library, what is this? This is something which came into your computer when you install Java in your machine. Fine. Actually, what happened? Nothing but various jar files, they came up in your machine. And inside every jar file, you will find lot of class files. Okay. So when you install Java on your machine, nothing happens, but all these jar files, they come and they are into your system. The same thing is with Selenium. Now this will not contain Selenium inside it. These jar files will not contain Selenium inside it. Whosoever made Selenium, right? Whosoever made Selenium made his own set of jar files, and he is asking us to download those jar files from his website. For example, if you go to this site, seleniumhq.org, and go in the download section, right, you will see this thing over here. Java 2.30 is the current version, fine, and you will see the download link. When you click on this download link, this will download completely. And if you extract the downloaded stuff, you'll see a folder like this. For example, on my PC, the latest version right now is Selenium 2.28.0. Okay, if you open this up, you will get two class files here: Selenium Java 2.28.jar, Selenium Java again 2.28.0-sources.jar. Along with that, these two jar files, there will be a libs folder. Inside this libs folder, you will have various other jar files as well. So these all jar files are of Selenium. People who made Selenium, they made lot of classes. Fine, they made lot of classes, and all these classes, they put everything together into jar files and they supply us the jar files. We just need to download these jar files and configure them in Eclipse. Just go to your Eclipse project and go to the properties, go to your Java build path and select libraries. Okay, in the project properties, Java build path, select libraries, click on add external jars, and you can add the external jars in your project. For example, in my case, I have the jars at this location. These two, and also inside the libs. So these all are the, hold on. If you look on Eclipse on the left hand side, you'll see that these are the jars of Selenium. This is how you download and configure Selenium in Eclipse. Selenium is not installed. It is not an exe file, which many people think. Okay, Selenium never comes inside an exe file. It is always configured inside Eclipse. Okay, many times people, when they add up Selenium jar files, they forget one thing, that you have to add these two jar files. Along with that, you have to add the jar files under library as well. Fine. So don't think that Selenium is installed. It is not installed, it is configured. That's how I just configured Selenium in my project. But now, in order to learn about Selenium, in order to learn how to use it, what are the various properties and all, fine, you need to have the concept of object-oriented programming very strong. Right? If I hold on. Right. So now I will actually go and talk about the concept of object-oriented programming. And then I will tell you how that concept actually is used in Selenium. Fine. Now, what are objects? How do we work with objects? What is an object-oriented? What do you mean by object-oriented programming? Right. For example, I will create a new class here. Okay. In this class, I will write types. This is very important. Okay. The concept of object-oriented programming, because the general architecture, the very basic of our basis of architecture of Selenium, right? Everything is object-oriented in nature. If you look at the documentation is completely object-oriented. So you need to understand the various concepts of object-oriented programming, and then you can actually understand Selenium very easily. Fine. Now what do I want to tell you in the types class is that there are something known as global variables in a class, and there are something known as functions. For example, I make a function like this. I am assuming in this course that you have the basic knowledge of programming. You know what statements are, you know what a function is supposed to do. If you don't know, right, I would not recommend people to directly join. I always tell them that instead of joining the course directly, you can also take up the videos, watch the videos, and later on, if you feel the need, you can join the course by paying the remaining fee. Whatever is the difference fee between the online training and videos, you pay that and you join the online training. This helps a lot because you come to the class with the background. Right? In online training, I have also restrictions. I have time restrictions and all everything. So it is tough to tell me to tell everything. Right? Or if you have to work on functions or something, you can go to my site. You can watch the video number 2. In this I have talked about functions. Right? So now I make a function called, say, public void xyz. Right? And I declare a variable on the top, int I. Now technically this function is known as non-static function. And technically this variable is known as non-static variable. Okay, fine. Now apart from this, there is another thing. If I make a function, say public static void abc, then technically this is known as static function, and technically if I make a variable called static string s, then this is a static variable. So variables can be of two types, global variables. One is non-static variable and the other is static variable. Similarly for a function can be non-static function, this is a non-static function, and a function can be a static function in which you can have a static word. Now what is the difference between static and non-static? First of all, the questions which arise are, what is the difference between static and non-static? Secondly, why they are used? And thirdly, how they are used in Selenium? This is the very basics, whatever I'm going to train you now. Okay, this will be the like very basic of programming. Right, object oriented programming. Fine. Now to help you understand this in a more clear way, right, let's make up a class. I'll make a new class, say let's name that class as mobile phone. Fine. Let's name this class as mobile phone. Now this is a single class called mobile phone which has got nothing inside it. Right? And I give some properties to this class. For example, string model of the phone, right? Int what is the number on which you dial on this phone, so that the calls they pick up. So what are these? Both of them are global non-static variables. Both of them are global non-static variables. And similarly, if I write over here public void call, and in this function I write system.out.println calling plus the number, right? This variable number. What is this? This is again a non-static function. Okay. Now, how will I use them? I use them by creating the objects of the class. Right? How do I create the objects of the class? You create a new class known as test mobile. Fine. You make a class known as test mobile with the main function. If a class has got the main function, then you can execute the class. Like I made my first program.java, this had a main function. This was public, static and all everything. Whenever this, in C also, the control bit first comes over to the main function and then it moves further, right? Out here also, Java, we have a main function which can be written in a class to execute the class. Now, mobilephone.java has got no main function. It's a standalone class. It cannot be executed. But yes, we can use the features of this class in some other class. For example, in test mobile. Fine. In test mobile, what I'm going to do is that I'm going to create object of mobile phone class. How do you create the object? You just have to write new mobile phone. If you are writing new mobile phone, what are you doing practically? You are creating the object of this mobile phone.java. I'm sorry. Right? Now, what do you mean by creating the object of this class? I'll talk about that. Let's take a 5 minutes break. Fine.